Kia ora tātou. Nā mahara mai. Ko tīmata kē. Tēnei wāhanga. Decolonising via Māori leadership. Nā mihi nui ki a tātou kua tai mai. Rāro te kaupapa. E huarahi mā tātou. Ki tēnei wāhi, introducing Grant Berghan and Tania Hodges. Now, ko Chris Weber tēnei, mihi atu ki a tātou, nā te tō rangatiratanga, nā te raukawa. For those of us who know Grant and Tania, there's few words that can explain, but in my 20 plus year history, he pou, he manu taiko, he rangatira, e pāna ki te kaupapa te oranga mō tātou. So we've known Grant and Tania working together and independently as leaders in the field, especially in public health and leadership, and inspiring and lifting Māori, especially in the health space. So we'll invite them to introduce themselves, but we'll just have our opening slides before we complete our formalities. Just reminding us the community code is here, taken as read, but just noting that our kawa here, curious, open, respectful, confidentiality, and sharing our experience, making the space safe. And collectively, we'll find a way through the kaupapa. There's some accessibility information here on the slide. We can go to that website and enter that password. Accessibility info sheet link is there. And a big mihi to our sponsors, all the people that help make this happen. Sponsors and allies, it's growing, whānau. And just a mihi nui ki a tēn, ki a koutou, all those that support the kaupapa. There's a call to join Kei Te Muru o Te Ahi. Join Friday on the 22nd, starting at 8:30. 5-hour marathon of short interactive talks. It's going to be an awesome collaborative initiative, so invite us all to join that. Nō reira, kia ora tātou. Grant, Tania, tēnā kōrua. Mihi atu ki a koutou, mā te haua, mā te maniopoto, pā hauera, mā te ranginui, ngā te tūwharetoa, tēnā koe Tania. Mihi nui ki a koe, e Grant, mā puhi, mā te wai, te rarawa, tēnei te mihi atu ki a koutou i tautoko ana te kaupapa, nō reira. Kia ora tātou, I'm just going to huatu te rākau ki a kōrua ki te whakawhanaungatanga. But whānau, this is we're couching it as a fireside chat, so just going to introduce ourselves and then we'll get into some kōrero. Ladies first, kia koe te tuahine.
Tēnā koe. Kia ora. Mauri ora kia tātou. Greetings to everyone that's online and listening. A special acknowledgement also to those who have passed and who are no longer with us. But have made a contribution, and also coming back to all of us who are here today, and particularly those that have helped create this wonderful opportunity for all of us to be here. Kia ora koutou.
Grant,
kia ora. Tamari, tēnā koe, ki a koe Chris, to my mate Tania o te rā, ki a koutou katoa, tēnā koutou. Welcome. This morning I was just having a coffee and I was having a look at a mate of mine, Sid Jackson. This is a really old mana magazine. I was reading the article on Sid and the mahi him and others have done, and you know, Tania and her acknowledgement of those who have passed on. You know, a lot of people come before us that have done lots of hard yards, and it's going to be the same with all of us listening in today. A lot of hard yards and good mahi and joy ahead of us. So, Chris, thank you for facilitating this kōrero. Mm-hmm. And to Nikki and Emma and those in the background who have done all this work to bring us together, ngā mihi atu ki a koutou, and hand back to you, Chris. Kia ora.
Kia ora. I'm going to reference just acknowledging those who aren't with us, but all of those who have been through the space that you guys have held open, and I'm referring particularly to the Māori Leadership Whānanga program, and this little kōhatu has been over at Cambridge there, Te Pū Waitanga, and been through the hands of many, just holding that Māori, because the Māori is in the mahi, right? And the space that you've been holding and the Māori that's developed there is present. And mihi atu ki a rātou that aren't here, all those who've gone before, all those that are part of the kaupapa, mihi nui ki a tātou, ai o ki runga, ai o ki raro, ai o ki a tātou katoa, Māori ora. So with that in mind, this program, really it's what's brought a lot of us together. And I think that's a good place just to start and invite us to have a little reflection on that. Emma, we were just reflecting on some of the beautiful quotes that come out of that space, because magic happens in that space, right? What was that quote? I'm one badass lactating mama. Okay. Tania, where did this program start? How does this music happen?
yeah. Well, it's always interesting, because I think our tūpuna, those that have passed away, and the atua have play a part in things happening when they're meant to happen. So back in 2001, Megan Tunks, who was at that time with the Ministry of Health, asked if I'd put forward a proposal for to facilitate a leadership program for Māori and public health. And really, since 2002, the program evolved, and others have been part of the program, whether it be Māori nurses, those in disability, the Ngā Manukura program, which is a clinical leadership training program for Māori nurses, midwives, and some of the physios. So since 2002, essentially, we've had, it'll be 66 cohorts have gone through, and more than 1,200 people over that time. Yeah, so the leadership program has been specifically for Māori who have Māori ancestry, and there's no scale about, you know, how Māori you need to be, but it's for Māori who have whakapapa, or what we call whakapapa, or ancestry, and it's evolved over time. So as it started off, we've always been sort of interested in how we can continually improve, but we have operated on the premise that everyone that comes on the program is a leader, which is slightly different from how the Western or other views look at leadership, as a specific person or a specific role that they hold. But for us, we believe that everyone has leadership potential. So we treat people as leaders as they come on. So essentially, in a nutshell, that's how it's sort of started.
Well, I was fortunate to be involved in that back in 2002, right at the early stages. I remember some of the people that came in and tautoko were part of the formula. Grant, you've been there for the long haul. How did you become involved? How have you felt coming into this program and supporting them?
I remember, I think it was about 2009. And I got a call from Tania, and Tania and I did our masters together. So we met each other and connected there. And I think in 2009, I got a call to see if I'd be available to fill in for a day. And it's March 2024 now, and there you go. And I think we'll get this, that things are meant to be, you know, the way things go, that you go with the flow with things. And so that's exactly what Tania and I did, we found very quickly, Chris, very easily, that Tania and I clicked. It was something above, beyond us. We always think that we're here to do the mahi of our tūpuna, and that, which is why, you know, when I say to my mate, you be you and I'll be me, and that the synergy of that works. We're completely different, Chris. Everyone knows this. Grant and Tania are completely different. But actually the coming together of the differences, the synergy that's created, which I think is beyond us, it goes beyond us, and that if we are true to who we are, then this is part of our journey in life, is to be able to be part of this leadership journey. And so we came together in 2009. I was only supposed to be there for the day. And then I was asked, you know, Tania said, hey, mate, you know, you want to come back? And sure. And then we just clicked, and we really do click. I know what she's thinking. She knows what I'm thinking. And then we just go with it. And here's the thing about leadership. First of all, it's not about management. It's way bigger than management. And so what happens is when Tania is able to be Tania and Grant's able to be Grant, and then we're there, it's not about us. It's not about us. There's a paradox in all things. And so if we just true to who we are, then things will happen. We operate more around intuition than logic and rationality. Although, of course, we understand logic, rationality, all that linear stuff. We're more inclined to the circular, the metaphoric kind of thinking and being. So there you go. Thank you, Chris.
Dana, did you have anything to add to that?
Oh, I just wanted to pick up on Grant's point around leadership's not management. And again, to the earlier point I raised around, we think it's specific people, but your management's more around how you manipulate people to do a certain thing, whereas leadership is around how you encourage people to achieve the vision or the mission, what they want to do, so how you support them. Because the job of a leader is to grow leaders, whereas the job of a manager is to manipulate and control people to achieve what you want them to do. So often people get that confused. So that's a real distinction that we need to realise.
Good point. Well, let's move on to that. The theme for this is decolonization via Māori leadership. And so you guys through this program have had a bird's eye view of the leaders being created in this space. So I'd like to just reflect on trends, highlights, things that you've noticed of people coming through the program. I recall coming out of a public health unit into that space, and you know, mind opened, hearts opened, connected up. Marae based, safe space, all those things, the elements that were going into making it a safe space to grow leaders. And then all the people that came through to talk to us. So any comments about the growth that you've seen, particularly in this decolonizing space? Because people were transformed, are transformed through this type of training.
You want to go, Grant?
Oh yeah, I'll give it a go. There's a deep dissatisfaction with the state of the world. And at the heart of that, there is this desire. It's a fundamental human desire to know who am I, this thing about identity. And my reflection is that over the years, when people come into the whanaunga, we come into a Māori space, and there's this real hunger about finding out who and what we are. So that's part and parcel of it. Then the second point I want to make is that we're very clear that this isn't about management. That if we're going to, we use the words decolonizing. I'm not so sure that I like the term, Chris. I'm not so sure I like that term, decolonizing. what it is, I think, is, first of all, it's not out there. It's here. It's this is not a journey that is external to the self. This is a journey that is internal. And so for us, everything begins here. So that if we're talking about, and I don't like the word decolonizing, really what it is we're on a journey to find out who we really are, Chris. And the context happens to be this thing called rangatiratanga. But actually, if you're not able to be the rangatira of yourself, firstly, then you can't have the ability to influence others, because everyone, it's not what you say, it is what you are. It is your being that people pick up on. So if I'm a fraud, people are going to pick up on that immediately. People pick up if Grant and Tania, you know, people pick up the bullshit. They really do. So in terms of the changes that we've seen over the years, then for me, there are three words that Tania and I talk about. We talk about shifting from the transaction, which is purely database information. We share information, which is an essential prerequisite to being human and living in this world, right? It's the transaction. The transaction suffers the lowest level. If you think about rangi, tāne nui a rangi, climb those rangi, the lowest level, the very lowest level, is the transactional level. Well, what we want to do is we want to go from transaction to transformation, transformation to transcendence. So to go up there, and in order to do that, that's the leadership journey, which requires pain and suffering, to tell you the truth. But I have noticed that in order for us to really, truly experience this thing in ourselves, which is about the leadership thing, we have to go in, and we've got to confront our pain. We've got to confront our fears. We've got to confront all that bullshit that's in ourselves and move beyond it. You can't do that without feeling the real pain for everything, the suffering in life that Yin talked about yesterday. So some quick kōrero there from me.
Kia ora, Grant. Tania?
So just to add in, it's about being comfortable in our own skin and reclaiming and acknowledging our space. Often people will, you know, sometimes people, particularly funders, here's an example, particularly funders will want to fund leadership programs so that they can, you know, keep people within their organizations and make a difference for the organization. And sometimes people will want to focus when they initially come on the program around their own career development and where they're going to go and what they do. But if we can turn that around, and it sounds a bit of a paradox, but actually it's not about ourselves and getting the best for ourselves. It's actually about what we do for others, and in doing stuff for others. And I remember David McKee, one of our speakers, who's been on the program for the last 22 years, you know, he speaks about, in actual fact, the more you give, the more you get back. And actually, you can never get to a point where you're, you know, getting when you, if you go with that philosophy. So if you give, you will get the difference and, you know, opportunities in your professional life, and you will get the opportunities within your whānau and the different things that happen. But the focus is take the focus away from what's in it for you, but actually how do you contribute to others. So and the legacies that you leave behind and the value that you add. And so it's about what you give rather than what you take. And the other thing, point that Grant's raised, which is really important too, is around being values driven. So we're quite staunch what we talk about, people being tika and pono. So it's about how do we operate with integrity, with honesty, with kindness, with compassion, and how do we engage the head, the heart, and our tummies. I'm trying to be really conscious for those international people listening, because we're so used to speaking Māori and having Māori words that, so, you know, our puku, as we would say to us. And so often when we just engage the head from here, and there's no heart or no poku in it, which is we eliminate a lot that guides us and also guides us into making the right decision or doing the right action. And that's one of the keys about leadership, is that we have to act. And we have to act also when sometimes we're by ourselves, by doing the right thing. And then the other thing is, as Grant's also mentioned too, about being the best version of ourselves. So we need to be challenged to go beyond just being comfortable, but how do we transform ourselves so we can make a difference to the things that need to be done? Yeah.
I think Chris, one of the hardest things for us as humans, and particularly when we're in the leadership space, is this thing called ego.
Mm.
You know, the status, you know, the all those things with going with someone who's important.
Mm.
You know, and so what we say is that when you come into the whānanga, and I mean, I know how difficult that is to let go of the ego, the challenge of detaching from the self, which is so difficult. But we think that is one of the essential things, is it's about letting go of the self. You know, if we talk about servant leadership and about serving others, which means you do have to detach from the self, which is why it's so uncomfortable for us to talk about ourselves, because our whole essence is about not about us. It's about letting that go, even though you need to accept certain things about the self. But it is about letting go of the self and being of value. It's you know, this whole capitalist society is about the self, right? Everyone's doing freaking selfies. Everything is about being selfish in this world. Well, our whole leadership thing is the complete opposite to that. It's not about the self. It's about being able to give and to share. It's reclaiming the social, you know, which us as Māori have, our whānau, our hapū, the reclamation of the social as opposed to the individual, that selfishness. Let go of the selfishness. Anyway, thank you.
Just to add in to there, and probably one way you could sum it up, and apologies for anyone who may be offended by my language, but it's really just cutting the bullshit.
Mm.
Just cut the bullshit. We don't have time for that. And for people just to be themselves. And the sooner you can do that, the quicker you can move on.
Yep. Beautiful. Whānau, you're getting a lot of supportive comments in the chat. People are loving the kōrero and identifying with what's being said. Just thanking Emma, our moderator. She's there to help facilitate. She's invited for questions, so do put forward some questions. We've got a couple here that I'll reflect into us as we probably turn from this inward to the outward. How do we achieve this leadership out there? Because a lot of what I've experienced on the program, helping people embrace, especially our tāonga tuku iho, those things that come from our culture, the power concepts, the energy concepts, the hau water. For our international guests, you know, we roll out these Māori words, we forget we're talking internationally when we say puku. If it's coming from the stomach, where we hold our emotions, you can read that energy, right? So in our culture is a Da Vinci code of how to read energies through our words and stuff like that. So beautiful stuff. And as we adopt those things, how do we become leaders with it? So there's a couple of questions here from Patty. I'll combine them too. How do you see Māori leaders making a significant difference to both Māori and non-Māori communities? How do Māori leaders work within management structures that are in our health systems? So let's turn our attention out there to how we're making a difference out there. And we've made some inroads in the program trying different angles on that.
I think it's important for us to, regardless of where we are, where we work or who we work for, one, hopefully there's an alignment of values between the organisation you work for and for some people there's not that choice because they've got to pay a mortgage and they might be in an organisation which doesn't align, but they're there for this particular time. But regardless of where you are, there's always opportunities to be what we call kaupapa driven, to make a difference and make a significant difference for the betterment of people, for Māori and others, and particularly those who are not privileged by the system. So one of the, there's lots of different things, and I think it's important, we encourage it on the leadership program, is to be connected with others so that you're not by yourself and you're not isolated. Because one of the challenges that happens, even with the best intentions, is that you may go in there wanting to make a difference, but when you get isolated and you're, occupied with either a racist environment or an environment that just continues to privilege the same people, then sometimes you can become exactly like them without even realizing, and become what we call, instead of being on the kaupapa, being driven for making a difference, you can become what we call a kupapa and be the biggest barrier to our people. So it's important to be connected with others and make sure you keep on keeping in check. The other thing that's really important is that we talk about being self-full. So self-full is different from selfish. Self-full is making sure that you keep your cup filled, because often many leaders will be giving from an empty cup, and that's only temporary. And we know many leaders who have died well before their time. And so how do we keep our cup full with the things so that we can continue to keep giving? So those are some initial thoughts.
And a couple from me. I don't think I can change anyone else. The only person I can change is myself. And that if I'm talking about the external and what my leadership style or what it should look like externally, then I think, Chris, that I need to model what that looks like. So in everything that I am, the way I talk, everything, my being, I've got to demonstrate that 24/7, all the time. And so I have to be that example that I'm, when my vision is for a positive, flourishing future for Māori, then as much as I can be within the limitations of my physicalness, I need to show that in everything. And then in relation to trying to change organizations and institutions and bureaucracies, as Tania said, and Tim Leary said the same, find the others.
Yeah.
You got to find the others. You got to have the coalition of the willing. We've got a coalition of bloody crack government at the moment. And we've got to find the coalition of the willing. And if we're going to change stuff, we've got to work. We've got to get the synergy. One and one is three, not two, three. That's what we've got to do.
Beautiful. And your allies may not necessarily be who you think they are. So we've got to be open to possibilities of who they may be. And often that's measured in your allies by not what they say, but what they do. Yeah.
So Heather's busy prompting people that have been involved in the program to comment. And I've asked the question too in there about what's made the most difference. People are agreeing with the demonstrating 24/7 leadership, coalition of the willing. Simon's posted a question in the Q&A, which I think is a good segue, about Māori leadership not being the same as the European construct and how we do it. Can you describe how Māori leadership is different and how leaders work with each other and influence to influence direction? Can't go past the marae model where everyone lifts where they stand, shared leadership model, but pea ko kōrua.
Yeah.
You go, mate.
It's it when I think about Māori leadership, I think it's similar to some of the things that we've already said about, for me, it's a significant difference that we make with and for others and other things, whether it be the tai or other kaupapa, underpinned by the values that are important to us. So it's the stuff that we spoke about before, that it's actually not about us, it's about what we do, and particularly advancing the kaupapa or the betterment for Māori and others who are not privileged from society or what we have, what's offered, and in a Māori context. So it's us being true to ourselves as Māori, being Māori, thinking Māori, and the other thing about being Māori is that there are lots of principles or values that we have, which are also universal values as well, about being good human beings. So in a nutshell, that's a start.
I'll have a go, Chris. I think the difference between, and I need to be respectful for my Pākehā brothers and sisters, but I think the difference between the Māori view of leadership, actually not leadership, just the worldview, and the Western worldview, is the difference between light and dark, in the sense that we have a much more holistic understanding of how everything relates to everything else. And so in a traditional sense, we've had this intimate relationship with te tai ao. So, you know, Native Lavish talks about that tupuna rākau. There we recognize that those things that are in our environment and in our cosmos, that we are intimately connected. There is this intimate relationship. So our relationship in terms of our worldview with the planet, with the cosmos, is an intimate, interconnected relationship. And it is not one of exploitation, which is the fundamental essence of the Western worldview, the capitalism. Everything is about exploiting resources, exploiting human beings. So there, in terms of leadership, we come from a different space in terms of our view of it, and where we come from is because our worldview is completely different. Mm-hmm. It is the same as other indigenous peoples around the world, those peoples who have a much greater understanding of the connectedness of all things. And I think so, right at the beginning, where we start our leadership, having a look at what the thing called leadership is, the Māori view is completely different to the Western view.
Just one of the other things, the good thing with Grant and I is that we, and even when we facilitate, we tag team in and out, and someone will prompt something, and then we think, oh, hang on, I want to have another say. And one of the other things that we haven't really touched on, but it's really important, is the thing around humility. So as Māori leaders, so it's not about us getting up and going, oh, you know, look at me, I'm the important one. And also I sort of also think of Manu Nehol, who's another speaker on our program, and you know, and Māoridom, there's a saying, you know, that the kumara doesn't speak of its sweetness, which is like a sweet potato for those that that are listening, doesn't speak of its sweetness, and she always reminds us, yeah, but we're not kumara. So but there's a balance between not being so humble that we're sort of like, but also not being too whakahihi or too boastful, or it's all about me. So, but to remember that there is a level of humility. So one of the things for Grant and I, with a leadership program, and in a sense it feels a bit uncomfortable even being online here, is that we've always tried to operate under the radar. And so that actually the success of the program is not actually Grant and I, it's not the speakers, but it's actually the people who come on the program and the fruits that come after being on the program. That's the success of the program. So so I think the humility is a good point for us to always remember. Yeah, it's not about us.
And if I can pick up on that, on Friday when Tania and I were together, Tania and I were talking about humility and openness.
Mm-hmm.
And then separately on the same day, one of our speakers, David McKee, talked about humility and openness. And then yesterday, Yin Paradis, he talked about humility and openness. And Carl Jung talks about synchronicity. That there are things that go beyond coincidence in terms of that connectivity. And so as part of our leadership thing, our leadership program, and I don't really, anyway, so as part of that, what we try and do is when you shift from transaction to transformation, you get into a different level. You get into a different level where suddenly Tania talked about these universal truths. The universality of truth comes together at a certain level, and these are the things that happen there.
Kia ora. Well, folks, so we're getting into some really nice organic development of the kōrero, and the comments are still coming in response to, you know, what's making the difference. We've got people talking about planting the seeds, standing in the tika and the pono, not the tikko, the tika. That's that bullshit that Tania talked about. You've got to separate out the tika from the tikko. The connectedness of all things. We're starting to talk of the magic too. Ngā tukuiho, those traits, values and stuff, the humbleness, yes, but also well, we might not speak of our sweetness, stand in your truth.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the tangas that come through, the wairuatanga, the manaakitanga, the whanaungatanga. So there's a couple of questions here I'll reflect together about where we go with these things. So Te Māra's talking about your views. What are your views of Māori moving from kawanatanga to kingitanga? Is that not our construct? So, you know, this is us stepping out of colonized space, because another question is asked for clarification about decolonization, the dislike of that term. I know we've talked a bit about indigenization and so forth of things. I suspect on the what you resist persists front, build what you want as opposed to trying to oppose what you don't want. So this question on dislike of the term decolonization, rather than individuals learning about themselves and orienting to giving. Can we tie those together in terms of where we might be going?
Sure. Did you wanna go or shall I go, mate?
You go, I'll come in.
Kawanatanga te kingitanga. Gee, these are really interesting times, eh? Yin Paradis talked yesterday about his belief that we're coming to the end of modernity really quickly, by the way, and we can see that manifest itself all around the world. And when I have a look at right now, 2024, March 2024, in the state of this country, and particularly the state of us as Mai Tātou Te Iwi Māori, I see this deep disillusionment that has been there for a long time around our ability to participate effectively in this thing called democracy. And because we have consistently not been able to achieve those things that we've wanted to in terms of being Māori, then naturally we're going to look to other models. Someone talked about, do we shift from kawanatanga to kingitanga? I think we need to reflect very carefully around where the shift goes. I do think that the shift is going to go to different models of mana motuhake. And those models of mana motuhake will be different in kaitahu, they will be different in Ngāti Pura, and they'll be different in Ngāpuhi Ngāti Hine. Indeed, even at the hapu level, they're going to be different. But I think what we're going to see is a deep exploration of what this thing called mana motuhake for us, the reclaiming of our rangatiratanga at the local level. Now, last year, Tania and I challenged our participants in our whānanga around what does that mean in the whānau? What does mana motuhake mean in the whānau? So given we live in a pluralistic society that has not been satisfying our needs, then what does that actually look like? In fact, they did an exercise. You had to do four things. It's interesting, Tania, because Kingi Tuheitia, in his address, when he said right at the end, at Tūranga Waiwai, be Māori, you know, use our reo, our tikanga, all of those kind of things. And I think that's where it's going to shift from kāwanatanga, whether at the national level it's a kingitanga or some other model, fundamentally the model is going to be local. It's going to be local, it's going to be whānau, hapu, and us reclaiming our sense of mana motuhake.
I think that the future's not fixed and the world's full of possibilities, and that and I sort of go with the approach of sort of like a tight loose tight principle where we want the betterment for our people and others. That's the tight part. The loose part is, but we may do it differently within our own regions. And then the tight part is, but then we're still achieving the same goal, you know? So the possibilities can be anything and everything. And important for us not to fix that we're locked into how the current system is. So whatever country you're in, these are the laws of the land. And so I'm not asking everyone to go and be get arrested or do whatever, but I'm asking us not to paralyze our minds around the possibilities of how we can do things. Yeah. What it's called, whether it's and the term was used, was it kāwanatanga or kingitanga? Was that the term that was used earlier? And whatever that is, I don't think it's necessarily kingitanga, if we're just talking about the kingitanga. But I think it's an end and end and end for the common purpose. Yeah.
And are we? More questions coming in, and this is possibly talking about challenges in the leadership space. So Patty's asked about some of our traditional structures, just as I mentioned, how do these aspects fit into Māori leadership today, I guess. Anonymous question too about kūpapa in the sector, who are both Māori, all pai organisations who gatekeep and keep the status quo and don't want to rock the boat. How do we deal with these things?
Oh, there's a whole heap of things in there. So yeah. If we go back to the first part of the question, which was around if we think about sort of tohungatanga, rangatiratanga, so the wise people and wise people from the past, and I think of Eri Mahinare, who used to be a speaker, has now passed, but I remember him talking about our people and how we would capture that we would hold fast to the things that worked, but we were also really open to innovation and entrepreneurship. So whatever, and that's the key around tikanga, or our practices or our protocols, that sometimes I think we get stuck in the past and think that, you know, what we call the dark ages, te aukohatu, or the stone age. But actually we need to be continually thinking about what serves us, still serves us well, and what we need to let go. So that's one part of it. Another part is if we think about Tarangi Kahike and Tikitu from many years ago, and they spoke about the pūmanawa of a leader. and a lot of that stuff is actually still applicable if you just interpret it in today's language. So there's lots of stuff from our past that's really, really important. And there's lots of things available to us here today that we can pull in if it adds value to where we're going around the betterment for our people and the environment and everything else. So that's one part. The other part about dealing with kūpapa, and sometimes, you know, we, all of us can be a kūpapa. So a kūpapa, for those that are listening from overseas, is like the biggest barrier to our people. And I think it's good to have connections and relationships with people. So, you know, even on simple things, like sometimes people don't even realize they're doing that. So sometimes a simple thing like, you know, having a hot drink with someone or going for a walk, doing a bit of a walk and talk and touching base and seeing what's going on for them and how they see the world and sort of sharing your views on different things. And because one of the things that people often will never refuse is their own ideas. So, you know, if you make that connection and you get an understanding and then and a bit of trust is formed, then you're able to have that dialogue with the other person so that you can sort of bring them on board. Some people you just want to sort of get a shotgun and go boom, but you can't do that, you know. and that's sort of the first thing to, you know, just let's get rid of them and just move on. And some people will always be like that because that's just how they are. But you but I think you give people the benefit of the doubt, particularly for me, if they're Māori, is that you'll have, you know, like I've had meetings, been in board situations where there might be, you know, only two Māori on there, and then they're sort of, you know, not helpful at all. And so had the conversations outside of the meetings and just made a connection around, you know, how can we work together on this? Yeah, to get on the same page. Mate, you got anything to add?
Yeah, just a couple of quick comments around kūpapa. I think how we're going to move forward is by getting above this lowest level of existence and getting up into here. When you get up into this level, at that level, this is about kindness, compassion, openness, humility, and that kind of stuff. I don't want to sound like too romantic about this because that's so damn hard to do, you know, forgiveness and all of that. But it is that level that we're going to need to get to if we're going to be able to address the challenges that are in front of us. So around kūpapa, they've got a different version of truth. Don't get caught up in the negative stuff. And then the final thing I want to say, just talking about those kūpapa you raised, Chris, I think our language and our framing in our head has got to change. So you know how this common stuff we have amongst ourselves about this intergenerational trauma. Tania and I and others have been talking about change the language for us as Māori, instead of intergenerational trauma, let's start talking about intergenerational flourishing and what does that look like.
Just another thing to add too, Chris, is that also we need to check our interpretation. Actually, are they a kūpapa? Because sometimes it may be that we're fixed and this is how things should always be. And I remember my nana always saying to me, you know, Tan, you don't have to like everyone to get the job done. You know, you've just got to get the job done. So that means that, you know, not everyone has to be your best friend to work with them. And you definitely don't want people that are all the same. But I think as leaders, we need to be open to possibilities that there's more than one way to do things. I take on that sometimes people and you know we all experience that. But yeah, be open to possibilities. And so the just with the possibilities is also be open to learning. And so one of the things that we say to people in the beginning of the whānanga now is that if your cup is already full in a sense that you think you know everything, then there's nothing for us to add. And we believe that learning is a lifelong journey. But if you think you know it all, then, you know, we just go, look, please leave now because there's nothing that we can add. Yeah. So I encourage all of us as leaders to be open.
Kia ora, kia ora. There's some comments coming through in the chat. And just personally, I thought heads on sticks was probably an awesome tool back in the day, but we can't use those today. Comments coming through, including from Bron, really enjoying this, and Pākehā wanting to be allies and get past, you know, the negative stuff. Reflecting Māori in all that we do. And a question coming through too about how our leadership can guide the conflict resolution required out there, especially on the local level, pertaining to whānau and hapū matters. Some of that we've spoken today about the personal traits and qualities we carry in, but as leaders, I just want to take a moment here to reflect. Heather's reminded us, both of you have been public health champions, celebrated as public health champions of the Public Health Association of New Zealand. Just acknowledge you both there. Organised efforts of society, and how we're doing that on the ground with the things and the magic that we bring through our culture and our leadership training, to now being invited to answer these questions. How do we solve some of these conflict resolution out there to make things smooth? Any questions in that space?
I mean, I always think that we need to think about what is it that we're trying to achieve, you know, and for me, it's always around doing the right thing, not the popular thing, but doing the right thing around, again, I feel like I'm sounding like a bit of a broken record, but you know, doing the right thing for the kaupapa. And so if we you know, in order to resolve conflict, we need to be open to listening. And I mean, you've got to move and you've got to get things done, but there's power in diversity, and there's opportunities, and you know, like in the times of chaos and conflict, there are still opportunities in there. So yeah, I'm probably not answering the question the best, but I think you treat people with respect. You work in a mana enhancing way, sort of in a way to get things. You were going to ask a question, Grant, Chris. Sorry.
Let me add to the question, because there's several questions with a similar theme. Not just, you know, Māori leadership to guide conflict resolution. Another question's asking about Māori leadership that's typically in tauiwi spaces, the soft skills and the knowledge base required. Also about your vulnerability as a leader. And finally, how receptive or resistant do you find Pākehā management to your approach? So here we're talking about our problem solving and ability to make things happen with, you know, what comes through the Māori leadership space, influencing both on the ground in our hapū communities and in tauiwi organisations, the soft skills needed, and our vulnerabilities too as leaders. One of ours is, if there's a lot of knives in your back, you know you're a leader, because in your back, right? Yeah. Kia ora.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll have a go. I think all conflict starts within. These are starts. So firstly, the resolution of conflict, we've got to look at ourselves. Is the first thing. Of course, there's conflict external to us, but all conflict starts within. I think we need to have a conversation. In Māori, we have the word tika. T-I-K-A. Which talks to us in our Māori worldview about being a good person. In the Western world, we talk about moral, ethical frameworks. And I think we need to really bring that stuff to the front about what does it mean to be a good person, a good human being. No one talks that stuff, or very few people, I beg your pardon. And so I think in terms of conflict, firstly, look at ourselves, because I think it starts within us. And secondly, I think if we want to resolve conflict, then we seriously need to have a look at what does it mean in terms of being a moral and ethical or a tika person in our language.
I just thought of another couple of tips for people when dealing with conflict. And one is being aware of your own strengths and working out and when you overplay them, and also working out who should be the best person to deal with the conflict, which may not necessarily be you. So having the right people there. Also, when you're doing it in a way that keeps the other person's intact, their mana intact. And another way of doing it is also talking in your pass the butter voice. So and we've talked about this on the leadership program. So just as an example, Chris, can you ask me to pass the butter to you?
Tēnā koa, humai koa te butter.
So you can see Chris in his asking to pass the butter, is there's no emotion in it. It's pretty, you know, easy. It's in a sort of a tone that's not threatening. So when you're having those tough conversations, because it's important to deal with conflict. We're not that great at dealing with conflict and we let the rubbish continue. So when you're dealing with the conflict, you're having those conversations, have your courageous conversations and your pass the butter voice, and you'll find people are more open and receptive. So there's a couple of tips for you, for the listeners.
Chris, can I touch on this vulnerability?
Quickly, because we're winding up soon.
Okay.
Kia ora.
I don't think you can be a leader unless you're truly true to yourself, and you can't be true to yourself unless you make yourself vulnerable in front of others, and the vulnerability enables trust and empathy with others.
I've saved a little something at the end, folks, because we've come to time, and I've just invited people to make any final comments in the chat. So there's lots of great comments there, kōrua. I want to talk about the magic, because it doesn't matter how many deck chairs you shuffle on the Titanic, but you know, we have fun on those programs. We have magic, we have wairua, we have spirit, we have heart, we have connectedness, we have love. And even I wanted to reference the music. We played a piece of music at the beginning because there's a special way that Tania and Grant graduate at the end of the program with the person's favorite music that they dance to, and see us all dancing in our beingness. Final comments to you two about the magic and the fun, and you know what feels so good and right when we're doing this stuff together.
I'll have a go. For me, it's just the magic happens if you just be you. Mm-hmm. Like if you truly are you, not someone else, not the persona, not all the bloody clothes you got on, but if you are honestly just you and just be, and then be present in the space, and then we use other things, music and other things, but actually we use each other. And flipping heck, man, there's magic in all of us, eh? There's a power.
Yeah, definitely. And to remember that we should be able to laugh, have fun, and that's the thing that we forget often, you know, in our seriousness, but to laugh and have fun and celebrate and create those magic moments, you know, with each other.
Nō reira, tātou mā, ko tai ki te mutunga o tēnei wahanga. So time's well spent. We've had some good kōrero about this. There's lots of inspiration going in the chat too. So ngā mihi nui kia kōrua, kia tātou. E tautoko ana ki tēnei kaupapa. What a good way to spend our morning. Leadership. The opportunity to create more leaders and magnify our effect in the world for change, for better. And especially with that Māori focus, you know, what's Māori is natural, and we as people and the traits and the things that we carry. Kia kaha tātou, let us be strong in that. And we'll just have a little close. Kia tau te manaakitanga ki runga kia tātou. Kia tau te Māori, te aroha, ngā whakaaro rangatira, te kaha. Kia parihia te ara, e whai, e pai ora. Kia tātou katoa, te tūru whakamaua kia tīna.
Tīna.
Hui e
tāna.
Tāiki e. Thank you, Chris.
Kia ora, thank you, Chris.
A question here about finding the whānanga. We can share some details around that, Tania. Would that be an email or contact who about the whānanga?
I'm happy to send it to the team, and then I'm happy for them to disseminate that.
Okay.
Otherwise, go on the website, Digital Indigenous, www.digitalindigenous.com.
Ka pai. Māori ora kia tātou. Ngā mihi.
Māori ora.
Māori ora.